Our next speaker is kind of a Renaissance man, activist, speaker, poet, writer, cheesecake baker, DJ. Please welcome to the stage, Victor Harris Jr.
Good afternoon. Can you guys hear me okay? All right. So I'm going to start off with my phone for a few poems. Hope you don't mind. And we'll get to more exciting stuff. So the first poem is called Falcor is My Homeboy. I have drop cards for CDs for sale. You can talk to me after. So first poem, Falcor is My Homeboy. I believe in dragons. Not the metaphorical kind, but the metaphysical kind. The mystical kind that flies through skies and raids villages unless virgins are sacrificed. The magical kind that breathes fire and does battle with wizened wizards wearing pointy hats and holding staffs. I believe in dragons because I can see evidence of their descendants scattered around the earth. You call them dinosaurs, but I know the truth. They are dragons who never lived long enough to learn how to fly. But my dragon survived so that he could pass the truth on to me, and I, as his righteous prophet, am here to pass the truth on to you. My dragon is the son of his father. Before there was anything, there was nothing but the father of my dragon. He coughed up a hairball and caught the sun aflame. A few millennia later, he had 7 bowel movements to form the planets, but he had plans for the earth. The earth was special, so he was careful in what he ingested, making sure that it was right for life. And now, in order to protect us, his most precious creation, he carries us through the universe in his claws. My dragon will one day poop planets, but for now he evacuates asteroids into the atmosphere. Science has been fooled into thinking they come from space, but I know the truth, and now so do you. My dragon did damage when he was younger, demanding sacrifices from believers and death to non-believers, but he is a kinder, gentler deity. He lives in the hills behind my house and protects me as his righteous prophet, and I give him thanks and praise when he uses his magic to make things go my way. And I plead for forgiveness when his angry footfalls causes the earth to quake. Science attempts to tell me that he doesn't exist because he has no influence on his environment. They say that there is no fecal matter congruent with a large lizard living in the immediate vicinity, that there is not enough food that exists in the ecology to feed one as large as he, but my dragon defies science. My dragon lives outside the scope of science. My dragon is magic. Physicists attempt to tell me that a dragon large enough to make the earthquake would need to be visible from space, and I reply with magic. They try to tell me that his wings would need to be immense in order to lift one so large, and I reply with magic. They try to tell me that fire could not physically exist in a lizard, that flammable expectorant is not enough to cause dragon breath, but an ignition system is needed as well, and I reply with magic. They say that the way my friends and family plead with me to get help, they say that the way I go on about my dragon, I must be crazy. And I can see that some of you agree with that assessment. But consider that every inhabited continent has legends about dragons. Consider that every human culture tells tales about these great beasts. If you would only consider that there have been millions of books written about these winged worms, if you only had faith the size of a mustard seed, you would see that that my dragon is real. Well, it was real until I reached middle school, when I had my first science class and I learned the scientific method. You postulate a hypothesis, arrange a test to check the validity of your hypothesis, and if it isn't valid, you must come up with a new hypothesis. But if it holds true, you need to submit your findings and experiment for peer review. Science tells us how the natural world works, and my dragon was admittedly untestable. Despite the mountains of mythologies, they had no foundation in reality. My dragon's existence became questionable. When I hit high school, I learned about biology, the way the human embryo progresses from single-celled organism to full-fledged human being. My irrefutable evidence got a little shaky because there was no need for me to be descended from a Treyu and the Empress. Then I got to college and learned about potassium-argon dating, the way an object's age can be determined by how much potassium-argon remains in its structure, and did some of my own research. I read the evidence and formula for the Big Bang, and by then my dragon had all but disappeared. Replaced by reason, I am more amazed now by my minuscule place in the universe, my own existence and its improbability. To quote Richard Dawkins, "We are going to die, and that makes us the lucky ones. Most people are never going to die because they are never going to be born. The potential people who could have been here in my place, but who will in fact never see the light of day, outnumber the sand grains of Arabia. Certainly those unborn ghosts include greater poets than Keats, scientists greater than Newton. We know this because the set of possible people allowed by our DNA so massively exceeds the actual people in the set of actual people. In the teeth of these stupefying odds, it is you and I in our ordinariness that are here. This is the way my belief in dragons dissipated into skepticism as maturity took me. There is a quote I read in a collection of mythologies that has stayed with me through the years. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, thought like a child, and reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. And yet, you continuously attempt to convince me that your deities are real." So normally I'm performing in front, well, I got used to performing in front of a more hostile audience, so it's more geared towards believers. This next poem is called Do the Right Thing, and there's a chant, I guess, I don't know if it's in the Black church specifically, or all churches do it, or some denominations do it, but it's God is good, and then the reply is all the time. So my friends would say that sometimes at the open mic, so I kind of wrote this in response. Do the right thing. God is good all the time is an assertion that can be evaluated using empirical evidence. But before we can come to a conclusion as a community, we need to agree on what these words mean. Being an atheist, I have no concept of this word God, but there are some ideas about a supernatural entity that I have picked up in my conversations with Christians. The God of Abraham is typically depicted as being all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-loving. Good is a social construct. My idea of good music and my 17-year-old cousin's idea of good music may overlap, but they will not be the same, since we grew up in different generations, in different households, with different influences. But the God of Abraham is often referred to as Father. So let's apply the qualities of what makes a parent generally good. To me, a good parent protects their child from danger and harm whenever it is in their power to do so. All the time is fairly self-evident. But the father figure, possessing the previously agreed upon qualities, will protect his children whenever it was possible in his power to do so. And being that he is apparently all-powerful, he should be protecting his children all the time. Now, we are frequently told that we are flawed, that because of a fall from paradise, the world we live in is cruel and uncaring, but God is loving and compassionate. And as Richard Carrier states, by definition, if God is compassionate, then he wants the same compassionate things that I want if I'm compassionate. And this moderately compassionate being trembles with anger whenever I encounter a child suffering. However, in his paper with a title that will be shortened to The Holocaust of the Children, Gregory Paul points out that throughout history, 1 in 8 conceptions have managed to reach the age of majority, with the low estimate of the human population throughout evolutionary history guessed to be around 100 billion people. This means that at least 700 billion conceptions have failed to reach puberty. Even today, it is estimated that 9 million children around the world will die each year before they reach the age of 5. So given these statistics of natural causes for death to the most defenseless and helpless among us, when I hear you make a claim like, God is good all the time, what I hear is, yes, children get raped by parents and caretakers at ages when they are still breastfeeding, but I'm okay, so God is good all the time. That yes, children are used to transport to their death improvised explosive devices in conflicts they can barely comprehend, but I'm okay, so God is good all the time. That yes, children die in tsunamis, earthquakes, tornadoes, hurricanes, and other instances deemed acts of God, but I'm okay, so God is good all the time. That infants often die in their mother's arms, but I'm okay, so God must be good. If a person should be judged by their actions and not their word, why can't I hold your God to the same standard? And if I can't understand the nature of God, then naturally, neither can you. How can you proclaim him to be good all the time when the plight of children throughout existence tells a different story? As David Hume paraphrased Epicurus, is God willing to prevent evil but not able? Then he is not omnipotent. Is he able but not willing? Then he is malevolent. Is he both able and willing? Then whence cometh evil? Is he neither able nor willing? Then why call him God? This next poem is called Better Off Dead. You might be noticing a theme to my titles. I like 80s movies. I like referencing 80s movies in the titles of my skeptical poems. I try to make sure that they at least refer to the body of the poem. You'll see that throughout. Better Off Dead. I've seen the error of my ways. I am now a believer, following he who claims to be the way and the light. Born of a virgin in the last days of December, he who so loved the world that he sacrificed himself, if only temporarily, on our behalf. Yes, I am now a worshiper of Horus. Oh wait, my mistake, I meant Zoroaster, Ra, Krishna, Karna, Attis, or Mithras, because the story of Jesus, the situations behind his conception, and the celebrated time of his birth have been told many times throughout history. But you probably don't believe in any of those prophets because they have faded away into anonymity despite their believers being just as arrogant as Christians, cocksure that their gods were the real ones with all evidence based solely on tradition, just like Christians. The reason Christianity spread through the Western world was due to Constantine's conversion and subsequent conquering of other pagan civilizations while continuing the Roman tradition of substituting pagan reasons for celebration with Roman Christian ones. Just look up the history of Easter or Christmas or Ash Wednesday. It's not that Christianity is any more true than the belief in Greek or Roman gods or Zoroastrianism or Hinduism or Buddhism. It's that its believers had more military power. Truth is not bound by geography, but if you look at a map of religious concentrations, belief turns out to be. Steven Weinberg said that with or without religion, you would still have good people doing good things and evil people doing evil things, but for good people to do evil things, that takes religion. The argument that atrocities done in the name of a religion is based on the perversion of its beliefs is fallacious, especially in the case of Christianity. Anyone who does so is employing the no true Scotsman fallacy, attempting to convince you that these men did not know God's will, but they do, when that cannot be true for two reasons. They have had no more interaction with their God than those who have committed the atrocities, and in the case of Christianity, there are many examples in the Bible of God-sanctioned massacres of enemies. For instance, Psalms chapter 137, verse 9, when God says, "Blessed is he who happily dashes babies against rocks." Is this a perversion of Christianity? Or in Joshua chapter 6, verse 1 through 24, when God entreats Joshua to bring down the walls of Jericho, to kill all the men and women of any age save the harlot Rahab and her household, to burn the town and kill the animals, is this a perversion of Christianity? Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, when Jesus says, "I did not come to bring peace, but a sword," is this a perversion or Christianity? Or in Luke chapter 14, verse 26, when Jesus says that anyone who comes to him and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brother and sister, and also his own life cannot be a disciple of Christ, consider the clergy and their scandals, or the Republicans and theirs, or your fellow churchgoers and theirs, perversion or Christianity. And as far as the safety of belief, Pascal's wager says, isn't it safer to believe in God and be wrong than not believe in God and be wrong? But in which God should I believe? There are thousands of gods worshipped around the world and thousands more worshipped throughout history. Even the Ten Commandments leave open the possibility for the existence of other deities, with the first commandment being, "Thou shalt have no other god before me." But I digress, because common African-American wisdom tells me that it has to be the God of Christianity. But with over 3,000 splinters, which sect should I choose, which each believing that it alone has the perfect interpretations of the Gospels, Christopher Hitchens said that the fact that all religions cannot be correct, the only safe assumption is that they must all be wrong. But perhaps you are not as familiar with modern atheist philosophers as myself, or do not hold them in such high regard, so I'll put it in the terms of someone with whom you will be more familiar. Homer said, and that's Simpson, not the ancient Greek poet. Homer said, suppose we've chosen the wrong God. Every time we go to church, we're just making him madder and madder. Have you even considered other religions? Studied their traditions and rationally and logically dismissed their beliefs based on reason, or have you simply done what most people do? Accepted the religion of your parents based on authority and tradition. To quote Stephen Roberts, I contend that we are both atheists. I simply take it one God farther. And when you understand why you've dismissed all other gods, you will understand why I dismiss yours. All right, so this one's titled Gorillas in the Midst. It's about, I guess you'll figure out what it's about. It's in the poll. Gorillas in the Midst. A poetic friend of mine admonished theists to let those who believe we came from monkeys act like monkeys. But facts are a faith-free institution and a poor competitor in the marketplace of ideas, so I'm going to act as facts advertiser. We share about 98.5% of our genetic makeup with chimps. And while we have not yet isolated the essentials of humanity, we can see some things throughout history that separates us from the other apes. Contained in that 1.5% are major things like fire, which gave us the ability to cook our kills, the ability to kill off bacteria that may have killed us in the past. Cooking aids in digestion by breaking down vital nutrients, which allowed evolution to shorten our intestines. It has even been postulated by scientists that cooking our food may have enabled our brains to attain their current abilities. The wheel exists in that 1.5%, which gave us the ability to make simple machines, which enabled us to ease our load, to share the work among a community of individuals. Farming exists in that 1.5%, allowing a select few people to feed multitudes, allowing the multitudes to focus their energy on other pursuits, also located in that top 1.5%. Pursuits like reason, science, art, math, poetry, mechanical ability, reading, writing, contemplating death, walking upright, ascribing a meaning to life beyond survival and procreation. That 1.5% is an immense difference when looked at from the bias of human exceptionalism. But also located in that 1.5% is the irrational hate of the other, is the Holocaust and the slave trade, racism, sexism, ageism, homophobia, are weapons of mass destruction, is the ability to alter the earth for good or for ill, is religion, is the ability to forego empathy based on the words of authority, is shame for acts that in any other species are only seen as natural, like sex and nudity. Located in the lower 98.5% that we share with other hominids is empathy and compassion. Monkeys, in experimental conditions, have chosen to starve when they think that the option to give themselves food will also harm one of their own. Somewhere buried in the base of the 88% of genes we share with rodents is laughter. Scientists have made lab rats laugh when tickled. In our tribal communities, a trait shared with wolves who share 75% of our genes, we used to hunt in packs. Lacking any discernible offensive or defensive advantage, our willingness to work together allowed us to bring down prey much larger and faster than ourselves. Our bird brain genes, 60% shared between the two, contain the ability to problem solve, fashion tools, and propagate languages. Located in the lower 40% is yellow, because that is the percentage of genes we share with bananas. Yes, Ray Comfort, bananas. So you can believe an ancient myth if you wish, that we and every other creature on earth were created fully formed by an intangible creator, or follow where the evidence leads. As for me, I'll take Terry Pratchett's point of view, I'd rather be a rising ape than a fallen angel. All right, this next poem is called, Oh God, You Devil. And there's a companion piece that I'll be reading after it. Dear God, I want to thank you for this body you've given me. But I do have one or two issues with its layout and capabilities. I mean, if we are, as your adherents would have me believe, your favorite species created in your image, then your imagination must have been exhausted after creating sunrises, sunsets, the ocean, its floor, and the majestic mountains. They are beautiful works of art, after all, but your imagination must have been expended after creating creatures to swim in the deep, birds to decorate the skies, and animals to populate the earth. They are awe-inspiring in every iteration, so I can only assume that your imagination was taxed when it came to creating my kind. Or perhaps the parts bin was empty, because these eyes you've endowed in me and mine are nice. I mean, don't get me wrong, they're serviceable, but they are nowhere near your best work. Sharks have clear covers to keep their eyes safe when attacking prey. The eyes of the octopus don't have the same blind spot as those of mammals, and the images aren't flipped. Hawks can see greater distances with more clarity, and insects have compound eyes that allow them to see in six directions at once, while we stub toes in poorly lit rooms. Our rods, struggling in low-light situations, leaving us susceptible to injury and predation. We can only see in black and white in our periphery. Our cones can only perceive a limited number of colors in the spectrum, and our necessary nerves and veins occupy the ocular surface, leaving them vulnerable to irritation and damage by the tiniest of your insects. God, this body you've given we suffers from one or two minor deficiencies, for instance. We communicate, eat, drink, and breathe using the same faculties, which almost makes it a certainty that we will one day choke in our attempt to acquire sustenance. Did you love the dolphin and the whale more than man? Are fishes and amphibians more favored by their creator than the humble mammals from which we've descended? The circulatory and respiratory systems of insects are so simple as to almost be inspired. Did you design them early on in the process? I mean, there are more body plants or insects than there are people on this earth. Did you pin them fresh off your first cup of coffee or whatever your drug of choice may be? Because I think after seeing some of your creatures, it's safe to assume that you were on some sort of hallucinogen. And speaking of circulation and respiration, why don't we use all of the oxygen we take in? And why are we land-based animals on a planet that is two-thirds water? Where the oceans, once so teeming with life that you could only see heartache and strife, your favorite creations, and so limited them to the land masses. This spine you've hung my mass on contains a curve so complex that I will have back problems at some point in my life. Whereas if we were in the ocean, that might not be. The same can be said for hips, ankles, and knees, and dear God, why can't I regenerate limbs? I'm not asking for an arm or a leg such as a salamander is able to do, but if the common lizard can regrow a tail, I don't think a pinky toe is too demanding of me. And dear God, why is my lifespan so short, only doubling in the last century thanks to science-based medicine, but still falling far short to the alligator and the crocodile, the tortoise and the parrot? Do these creatures, not purported to be your favorites, have more purpose than man? And what is the purpose of cancer? Why do our cells suddenly go crazy and attempt to kill off the body that contains them? And our appendix, which was once necessary to break down such fibrous materials as grass and hardy green vegetables, is now a repository for necessary bacteria, a ticking time bomb in our abdomen. I'm running out of time, dear God, but not complaints. However, I do have one or two more for you to address. My party center, centrally located, is in too close proximity, at times sharing the same facilities as my sewage center. Were there no city planners up there in heaven for you to consult? Were we given whatever body plan was left laying around? Would that explain the junk DNA that sometimes occupies ourselves, dear Lord? Never mind. Don't answer that last question. There's no need. I only need to look around at all the different religious denominations that claim to speak your truth to know the real truth. So I humbly await your answer, dear God, if you can be bothered. But can you do me one favor? Tell your believers to stop speaking for you because they are all offering a different answer, each incompatible with the other, and attempting to disprove 6 billion ideas of you is really beginning to piss me off. So after I was performing that poem for a few weeks, a friend of mine asked me, what changes should be done to the human form, you know, with all these deficiencies we have. So that led to part two. Dear God, I want to thank you for this body you've given me, but I do have one or two issues with its layout and capabilities, so may I suggest some upgrades for version 2.0? My party center, centrally located, is in too close proximity, at times sharing the same facilities as my sewage center, so may I suggest that you move our excrement exits to the soles of our feet, liquids out the left foot, and solids out the right, still under voluntary muscle control so that I can keep my kicks so fresh and so clean. Give us wings like those of the sugar glider squirrel so that I will be able to see things from a new perspective. On a world so large, we are limited by our pedestrian abilities. Give us eyes with the ability to see infrared so that pareidolia will not be a necessary adaptation by my mind as a means of ensuring survival. I like the chameleon's coordination skills so that my skin tone could match my mood and environment. Gills to give us the ability to explore the two-thirds of our world that are currently contained in dihydrogen monoxide. This might also eliminate the more than 17,000 children under the age of 4 that attempt to come stay with you each year by acting on their natural, some might say God-given, curiosity by placing things in their mouths or exploring bodies of water that can be less than an inch deep. Give us a more efficient process for extracting oxygen from the air we breathe, or even a way for us to extract energy from the rays of the sun so that we will no longer need to feast on the flesh of your beast. Give women the ability to determine whether or not they want their eggs inseminated by their current partner, and better birthing canals for the female of the species so that given birth will not be a danger to mother and child. Give us a better understanding of the perils faced on the journey from zygote to embryo to fetus to eliminate the stat that 1 in 4 women will suffer a miscarriage in their childbearing years, or better yet, just stop killing kids in their mother's wombs. I can only assume that your imagination must have been exhausted after creating sunrises, sunsets, the ocean, its floor, and the majestic mountains. You have beautiful works of art, after all, but your imagination must have been expended after creating creatures to swim in the deep, birds to decorate the skies, and the animals to populate the earth. They are awe-inspiring in every iteration, so I can only assume that your imagination must have been taxed when it came to creating my kind. I mean, if we are, as your adherents would have me believe, your chosen species, there would be no need for me to plead for upgrades to the human form. So never mind. Scientifically minded men have stepped in to fill the void in our development after over 2 million years of undirected evolution. People like Orville and Wilbur Wright, who gave us the gift of flight, or William Spicer, one of the pioneers of modern night vision goggles, or Frenchman Sieur Fréminet, who came up with the first self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, better known by its acronym of SCUBA, or Carl Gerasi, inventor of the modern oral contraceptive, AKA the pill. And I know that some of your followers will attempt to tell me that these men and their work are expressions of your will. But that still leaves the stat that you kill 1 in 4 children before they ever have the opportunity to inhale their first breath. And that's just in America with all of our technology. So please, before your adherents speak about your greatness and unending love and compassion, have them explain away that fact. Until then, I will place my trust in the science that works. This next poem is called Flight of the Navigator. It's based on a real conversation I was having with a friend, with someone I was attracted to back in the MySpace days. So it was literally decades ago. All right. And it is actually the first atheist poem I ever wrote, the first one I performed in front of the open mic that I DJed at. Flight of the Navigator. She asked of me how I could be G-double-O-D if I do not believe in he that is supposed to be my Lord and Savior. Asked what motivating force kept me from doing my darkest desires if I did not fear the retribution of an omniscient being. So I ask of you, my friends, how many atheists have been rocked by scandal where they were the vandal upon the body of an underage child, only to have their organization deny, hide, and defend these men from the retribution due them by the laws of the land? How many secularists practice hypocrisy, preaching the nobility of poverty from the pulpit while living richly off the donated dollars of their impoverished flock? How many skeptic parents have kicked out their Christian children for daring to question tradition? I mean, what war was ever waged in the name of humanism? How dare religion attempt to hold morality under lock and key when the leaders can't agree on what is moral? You want to discuss religion and morality? Then let's talk about the Crusades, the Inquisition, the implicit agreement to the slave trade. Let's discuss how missionaries have been footpaths for colonialism. Let's discuss Pope Pius XII's silent consent to the Nazi movement. Let's discuss religious men making martyrs of innocents using planes as manned missiles against the land of infidels. Let's discuss Pope Benedict XVI's proclamation that condoms promote the spread of AIDS in infected Africa. Let's discuss the papacy okaying the excommunication of Brazilian mother and doctors for performing an abortion on raped 9-year-old impregnated with twins by her stepfather, while religiously stepdaddy walks away scot-free. Let's discuss religious anti-abortion advocates advocating for the assassination of doctors for performing legal and at times necessary operations. Let's discuss religious anti-abortion advocates advocating for the elimination of social programs in a world where poverty and access to resources kills more kids than abortion ever could. Let's discuss religious anti-abortion advocates advocating for war and the death penalty. Let's discuss how religion keeps the masses on their asses, happy with the here and now, believing that their kingdom will come in the hereafter. Let's discuss how religion makes second-class citizens of women. Everything that goes wrong in the Bible can be traced back to a woman from the Garden of Eden on down. So question my morality because I don't believe, but I think you should defend yours based on the history of those who follow he that you most wish to be like. But you will demand of me to take the followers of faith on a case-by-case basis while practicing your prejudice towards atheists based on some preconceived notions of those who don't believe. Get to know us personally. Ask of me how I could be DOOD if I do not believe in he that is supposed to be my Lord and Savior. Ask what motivating force keeps me from doing my darkest desires if I do not believe in the retribution of an omniscient being, and I will tell you what I do believe. I believe that all of humanity is connected, that what happens half a world away may one day affect me or my two nieces. I believe that children should be taught to think critically about what they hear, what they see, and what they believe. I believe that deeds done behind closed doors between two or more consenting adults is nobody's business but their own. I believe that religion is just the division perpetuated by the powers that be to keep me and you from focusing on what really matters most, just like race, just like gender, and just like sexuality. I believe that morality doesn't come from God or Allah or Yahweh or Muhammad or Jesus or Buddha or the Bible or the Quran, but is instead a basic human element that allows us to further the existence of our species. I believe that all the pain and suffering I've seen in my family and indeed all of the world is not caused by an omniscient, omnipotent being that is just testing us or can't be bothered to help, but it's something that we can all work to eliminate. I believe that no God means the possibility of less suffering in the future. I believe that if all the world were like me, we would see that every species is connected and be better stewards of this one earth. So before you question my morality because I don't believe, be prepared to defend yours because you do. This next poem is called Weird Science. It was a writing prompt on God, death, and the meaning of life. And I had a week to write it, and this is what came out. I am an amazing amalgamation of milliseconds, a compilation of coincidences, a collection of infinitely small spans of time that separates me from the possibility of my bloodline. I've managed to outswim 500 million of my brothers and sisters to be here today, continuing a chain of happenstance that began moments after the Big Bang brought the universe into being. Matter and energy cannot be created or destroyed, so the same molecules that make up me in this instance have been in existence for over 13 billion years. We are heavenly, but there is no godly hand evident in the creation of man. I can instead trace evidence of my being into the cosmos. The same elements that make me unique have been sourced to create the universe. I mean, forget Jesus. Stars died. Galaxies gave their lives to form my fingertips. How could I not find wonder in waking up? Be more amazed at each day that I open my eyes. Each day I'm granted more time on this little blue marble floating through the vast emptiness of space. I am in awe of life. To quote Carl Sagan, I find it elevating and exhilarating to discover that we live in a universe which permits the evolution of molecular machines as intricate and subtle as we. I am left breathless by the understanding that my continuance is an example of the improbable versus the impossible, and despite what some might think, this makes my life more precious, lends weight and reality to the precious actuality of each person that I allow into my life, because I see that they are an amazing amalgamation of milliseconds, a compilation of coincidences, a collection of infinitely small spans of time that separates them from the possibility of their bloodline. So I offer assistance where I'm able, compassion when I can, and a hug when life's weight proves too great for them to stand, because these memories will be the markers of my legacy, allowing me to exist for eternity, or at least a few years past my mental exit from this planet, a few years past my physical exit from this planet, a few years past that moment in time when my atoms are reconnected with the cosmos. I live my life relaxed and happy, because I know that I could be gone tomorrow. And like Stephen Hawking said, when your expectations have been reduced to zero, then you truly appreciate everything you have. All right, this next poem is called Project X. It's about the law of attraction. Gravity, as far as we can tell, has always been. We tend to think of it in personal terms, as a force that keeps us grounded, but it is much more than that. It keeps the moon close, makes the tides and the sunrise predictable, keeps the planets in their orbit, keeps the galaxies in theirs, and keeps the universe together. It is literally the fabric upon which the universe sits. Observed and quantified on Earth in the 17th century by Sir Isaac Newton, the force of gravity is predictable. An object falls to Earth at a rate of 32 feet per second per second. In a perfect vacuum, it will keep accelerating, but due to the friction of our atmosphere, most objects have a terminal velocity, or the speed at which their fall becomes constant. For humans in a random position, this is about 120 miles per hour. And with intention, up to 200 plus. All of this is to illustrate the weight of the evidence detailing the law of gravity. Can you tell me who discovered the law of attraction? When did it come into power? What has it been quantified as? Where is the evidence to support the hypothesis? Where are the peer-reviewed scientific papers? Or has the language of science been co-opted to promote a sexist, racist, pseudoscientific assertion to excuse those born into positions of privilege from feelings of guilt? Because if I can use my power of attraction, power anyone can tap into to become rich, then I don't need to acknowledge the unfair systems already in place to keep me in power. If the law of attraction always existed, then men attracted dominance and wealth better than women. Then Europeans attracted wealth and guns more effectively and sustainably than any other culture. If the law of attraction is the reason for everything that happened throughout history, then who the fuck do we blame on the continent for the enslavement of my ancestors? Who attracted that deadly boat trip to the Africa's shores? The secret and the law of attraction is slickly packaged method of victim blaming. Because if you get wealthy by attracting wealth to you, then the poor are to blame for their own situation. Then rape victims were asking for it. Then starving children shouldn't be saved. They simply need to learn the secret and how to attract food and health. Most scientific theories before being introduced to the general public go through a peer review process. The ones that are first introduced to the media before their peers tend to be revealed as false. As fake science is based on faulty assumptions and unrepeatable evidence. The men and women who promote the law of attraction have no accreditation from reputable universities. They've not had their conclusions properly vetted by people qualified to do so. They simply sold it to you in books, motivational talks, and feel-good videos, compromising a multi-million dollar industry. The law of attraction does make people rich, but none of those people are in the audience. If you want to grow riches, you need to do more than just think about it. You have to take actions as well. All right. So this next one was entitled Say Anything. It distresses me how tenaciously my people hold on to Jesus. When God, Jesus, Jehovah, and Allah never fell from the lips of our ancestors as they were trapped in the bellies of boats bringing them across the Atlantic. Raping them of the only home they ever knew, these same gods enabled our enslavers to see us as nothing but chattel. Below human beings, because their holy books, falsely attributed to the hands of gods, were written by feeble-minded men who never walked more than 100 miles outside of their villages, men who had no knowledge of distant lands containing people who did not resemble them, distant lands containing people who resemble me. My ancestors were victims of a misunderstanding, victims of an arrogance that allowed men to lack the will to hate those they enslaved, because hate is something reserved for equals, and their gods gave them domain over land and animals. So if my ancestors were only ever seen as animals in these men's eyes, then why would they waste energy hating me and my kind? My ancestors prayed to different gods who, as far as I can tell, never lifted a finger to help them, who, as far as they could tell, never lifted a finger to help them. So it only figures that they would adopt the god of their enslavers, who, as far as I can tell, has never lifted a finger to help us, has never attempted to dissuade his followers from practicing human trafficking. In fact, a careful reading of Leviticus chapter 25, verse 44 to 46, instructs the chosen ones to find bondsmen and bondsmaids from neighboring nations, tells them to buy bondsmen and bondsmen from neighboring nations, tells them that the offspring of these purchased people should be passed down in perpetuity, but that they should not rule over their brethren in the same manner. Well-mannered men and cultured women would attend slave auctions on sunny Sunday afternoons fresh from church, because these were social events, watching men, women, and children sold to the highest bidder. Picture feelings form deep in the bellies of black men and black women as they watched their families sold away, powerless to rebel, compelled by Sunday's sermon to honor their enslavers. Today's reading comes from the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verse 22, which tells you to honor those who are your earthly masters with singleness of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever your task, work heartily. And I can hardly believe that we have shaken off the shackles of slavery and yet remain shackled so willingly to the religion of our former masters, accepting their assertions of a loving and benevolent God as they aim pistol and whip at our naked flesh, accepting their assertions of an omniscient and omnipotent God as they aim community and belonging at our raped, raw feelings of being, with us refusing. Still, to confront the notion that a God who's supposed to be compassionate and caring allowed one culture to enslave another for economic gain, that a God who is omniscient would have foresaw the downfall of Adam and Eve, would not have placed temptation so easily within reach, would not have given the serpent the power of speech, that an omnibenevolent God allows atrocities like Haiti to happen, at times being given credit, refusing to edit the record to reflect more favorably on belief in a deity, that an all-powerful God allows evil to exist in a world that is inhabited by what are supposed to be his most favored creations. My ancestors prayed to different gods who, as far as I can tell, never lifted a finger to help them, who, as far as they could tell, never lifted a finger to help them. So it only figures that they would adopt the god of their enslavers, who, as far as I can tell, has never lifted a finger. All right, two more poems. This next one is entitled Attack of the Clones. This is for the black girls and black boys with backbone. the ones strong enough to stand up to peer pressure, the ones who understand that to be weird is the natural state of things, that normalcy is the pursuit of the unimaginative, the ones brave enough to go it alone when your community expects you to be the next Jordan, Jackson, or Little Kim, the ones who spend hours in the lab, practicing science experiments and math equations, the ones more familiar with the accomplishments of Charles Drew than boxer Jack Johnson, the boys and girls more familiar with the lyrical cadence of Sagan and DeGrasse Tyson than Lil Wayne or Young Jeezy. This is for the little boys and girls who turn down rewards to shoot free throws at Warriors games because in conflicts with their science fair. True story. This poem is for the intellectuals, the boys and girls who will be the shapers of tomorrow. This is for the kids who will kick your ass in Trivial Pursuit, Scrabble, chess, Scattergories, basically any board game that requires intellectual or unconventional ways of thought, the boys and girls who spent afternoon hours with Bill Nye instead of 106 in Park, for the children who would rather stay in and read than go out and play, the ones who would rather go out and play than stay in and PlayStation or Xbox. This is for the adults who spend Saturday nights engaged in discussions about politics and religion before hitting the club for drinks and dancing. This is for the adults who spend weekends in lecture halls simply because they love to learn. The ones whose literary library rivals their musical library. Hell, the ones who have a library. This is for the bibliophibians, the ones who inhale paper and exhale ink, who live between the pages and whose habit is the written word. This is for those unafraid of being labeled different. This poem is for us, the stenographers of the everyday. Thank you for letting me be myself, safe in the realization that I am not alone. All right, this is the last poem. It's called Graduation Gift. I have two nieces, 5 and 3. I'm gonna get this, 5 and 3. And this was written when my first niece was born in 2011. I wrote in 2012. To my two new nieces, Bryce, Elizabeth, and Riley Noel, on the occasion of your separate graduation from high school, some words of advice as you prepare to leave us to make your way in this world. This society will attempt to compartmentalize you, place you in boxes so they no longer have to consider you, be it the female box, the male box, the office worker box, or the artist box. Refuse to be boxed, because normalcy is the pursuit of the unimaginative. Be imaginary, the person the little kid in you always imagined you would be. Learn to love life like you used to. Refuse to reminisce about the joys of childhood and instead work to haul them into your everyday. Get lost in daydreams made reality, playdates played out as your daily routine. Make friends with someone because they sat next to you. Be the kid you miss. Craft the childhood you never had a chance to experience. Be precedential. Set precedents. Do something new. Have never included in your list of attributes, like I never heard of a brother baking cheesecakes, DJing, racing cars and writing poetry. Never met a man that managed to raise 3 kids, one by coastal on a poet's salary. Never heard of a radio personality who persistently exceeded expectations in pursuit of his dreams. Be inspirational. Shun those who would attempt to claim pride in your work without doing work of their own. Don't apologize. Be intentional in words and deeds, and you will never have to offer another phrase of remorse for the ill-conceived perceptions of others. If they don't understand you, keep talking. There are those who will. It is for them that you are sharing your voice. Never let show some respect be synonymous with shut up. Have enough respect for the strength and courage of others to tell them the uncomfortable truth, especially when they're asking for it. Life is too short to live with regret. Tomorrow may always be a day away, but death is always lurking, and society will attempt to convince you that your bucket list can be put on hold, when in reality, your bucket is always with you, waiting to be kicked. It is the uncomfortable truth of our fragile existence and one that we must all come to grips with, old and young alike. This is the only life you are guaranteed. Live like it. You are the consequence of chances of unimaginable proportions. Take some. Every person you meet is living an equally improbable life and should be treasured with each encounter. Act like it. Awake with the realization that today has the possibility to be the best day of your life, and love like it. End each day by saying there is nothing you would do differently, even when you can't recall exactly what you've done, and sleep like it. Remember that she who has the most toys still dies. Live life without clutter. Live life without fear. Live life without surplus, so when death does finally find you, it will not find you wanting. Find eternity in memory. Turn legendary possibility into manifested reality, and never doubt that my love for you comes without condition. Thank you, Skepticon.